Reverend Theophilus Lemo. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
For God's message of exhortation. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand, please, our Lord.
Praise God.
Amen.
Satan is definitely a liar. Amen. Praise the living Jesus. Amen. Amen. We thank God. Amen. Almighty Father, we are so happy. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us to your sanctuary this evening, O Lord. We thank you for the privilege that you've given to us. We are about entering into the new year. And we thank you, Lord, for this word of mercy that you brought to us, O Lord. We beseech you to sanctify your word. Consecrate the tongue that will deliver it, O Lord. And let it be an open door for us in the year 2030. In Jesus' name, Father, we pray.
Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. The message for this evening or this night is saved by grace of God.
Amen.
Saved by grace of God. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, great in loving kindness. The Lord is good to all, and his mercies are all over his works. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord. And your godly ones shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power to make known to the sons of men your mighty act and the glory of the majesty of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout generations, as we read in Psalm 145. 12 months ago, some of us gathered here before the sanctuary of Christ with contrite hearts, with the eyes of our hearts looking up to the hills, from whence cometh our help. We raise our voices to Jesus in complete awareness of the dangers and uncertainties that lay ahead of us from January to December 2012. We were faced with fear of the unknown, not knowing who will survive the stormy seas of the year. But because we are children of God who had received grace through Christ Jesus, we embark on this journey with faith and hope of seeing the end of this year. Today we are gathered here like the pilgrim fathers giving thanks to the Almighty God who has protected us to see the end of this year 2012 through the grace of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Glory and adoration belong to God in the highest. What then is this grace? It is the gift of the Almighty God from which we receive mercy, forgiveness, loving kindness, and salvation for our life. It is because of God's grace that the Lord addresses all our indefinite attitudes towards Him and our rebellious hearts, despite all the good things that the Lord lavishes on us every day, which we do not deserve. For example, if you look around us and think back how many brethren started the year 2012 with us in this church, in our community, and those we know, how many are still around today and still marching forward as onward Christians? Not all. Some have fallen by the wayside into the wilderness of the world, and some have backslid into the abyss of darkness and confusion with no clue whatsoever about their lives. We that are here today still making progress despite our ups and downs and series of crises and storms of life We have survived. We are hereby giving glory to God for still retaining our spiritual well-being. How many of us have ever sat down and meditated or think how we were able to do it? I am certain none of us will ever think it is because we are clever or better than anybody else, but that we have survived through grace in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
God is so gracious in action that He has unlimited capabilities to forgive our sins and bless us. If Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, why then should we not give up everything to follow Jesus and stop looking back?
Amen.
We have heard of divine grace. The doctrine of divine grace is the pillar upon which the Old Testament and the New Testament is based. In the Old Testament, divine grace was being anticipated, being made ready for its full expression in the New Testament. It is in the New Testament we really understand and appreciate the gift of divine grace. In the Old Testament, Exodus 34, 6, God reveals Himself as a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. And this knowledge of our living God affords us undeserving sinners the privilege to be able to approach God with prayer. And He said, "If now I have found grace in thy sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray thee, go among us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for thy inheritance." Through grace, God removed us from our sinful state, which had separated us from the love of God, into full acceptance that opens the way for reconciliation and redemption. Why does God have to preserve our life despite our failure to love Him with all our hearts? Some of us worship Him whenever we feel like, and some of us even believe that everyone has the privilege to serve God according to our own choice, without any consideration for the adverse effects our action may affect the life of the church. God's divine grace was already at work when our first parents, Adam and Eve, disobeyed God and were stripped of all benefits to be obtained by obedience. But through grace, He gave us another chance, as we read in Genesis 3, 21-24. And God's call to Abraham was another testimony of God's divine grace. God had compassion on humanity when He saw how we were suffering and languishing under the yoke of His curses upon us because of the disobedience of our father Abraham and Eve, and He had to execute His second master plan to redeem humanity from the slavery of sin into which Satan deceiver had put us. God found righteousness in Father Abraham, even within the sinful and idol-worshipping community in which he was staying, as we also read in Genesis 12, 1-4. And God had hence called Abraham out and consecrated him as a chosen vessel, through whose seeds all the families of the world will be saved. Because of grace, this promise was applicable to all Abraham's offspring, and not only his racial descendants, the Jews, but also to his spiritual descendants, believers from all nations, as we read in Romans 4, 16. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end of the promise, might be sure to all seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. It was God's plan for redeeming all believers from all nations. In extending His grace to Abraham, God was also establishing the beginning of the church, the community of grace. And this is why today, the church is the last resort of refuge for all of us. The church is the last hope to seek for and obtain mercy and comfort from fellow Christian brethren. The help you could not get from relatives and the world, the church is always the last resort, and we have never been disappointed. Unfortunately, some people have formed the habit of believing that if I attend church services on days of special occasions, like the first Sunday of the year, the Easter Sunday, the Mother's Day because there will be plenty to eat, the Father's Day because there will be plenty to drink, and Thanksgiving Day and Christmas Day and the Wash Night Service because I need Jesus to protect me for the new year, They believe they have fulfilled the wishes of Christ Jesus, the founder and head of the church. If, like the children of Israel, we were given the Ten Commandments with the condition that it is by our strict obedience to all the commands that we shall or can be saved, how many of us here can stand up and affirm that he or she will be saved by works alone? Because of his mercy and loving kindness on us, he executed the second plan of redemption through his Son, Jesus Christ. The law was just a temporary measure that prepared us for the grace that was to come by faith in Jesus Christ, as we also read in Galatians 3, 23-29. But the scripture had concluded all under the sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up under the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise. And Hebrews 10, 1 says, for the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never, with those sacrifices which they offer year by year, continually make the comers thereunto perfect. The concept of grace, that is God's active involvement on behalf of his people, receives a sharper focus in the New Testament. Divine grace becomes embodied in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus demonstrates visibly the dynamic nature of God's grace, and his ministry fulfills the promises of grace for everyone, which is found in the Old Testament. And let us see John 1, 14 to 17. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this was he of whom I speak. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his faithfulness and fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God's grace received in Jesus Christ makes it possible for God to forgive sin and to gather sinners into the church, the new covenant community. During his ministry, Jesus repeatedly pronounced the words of forgiveness to a great number of sinners and ministered to a variety of desperate human needs. The parable of the debtors illustrates this better in Luke 7, 4-47. And through teachings such as the prodigal son and the search for the lost sheep, Jesus made it clear that he had come to seek and save those who were lost. He did not give up on sinners, even though they are his sheep who did not hear or know his voice. Ultimately, it was his death on the cross that enabled sinners who repent to access God's forgiving and restorative grace. This simple truth is described as the doctrine of justification by faith through grace. The book of Romans 3:23 said, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. According to this teaching, Jesus substituted himself for us by dying so that we could be declared not guilty. As a result, repentant believers enter into God's eternal plan of grace, which enables them to participate in the purifying work of the Spirit of God. God has hence extended that divine grace to all of us who are ready to surrender ourselves in the new year to be considered worthy of being extended this divine grace to serve God. God has given each individual a gift or a talent which, if not used or developed, may be taken from us. Some have talents, and when that talent is being misused or denied to God, the talent may be taken away and given to someone else. we have to surrender, or we have to understand that it is when we are winning souls to Jesus through our talent, maybe in preaching or in teaching or in prison worship or in singing, because many a times we say more effective prayers in songs which go around than praying to a select group of people within an enclosure. Whereas your song is being sung all over the world, praising and affirming that Jesus is the Savior and Son of the living God. And Satan will employ all ways to derail you with his many evil methods, like fornication, alcoholism, insubordination, uncontrollable anger, laziness, and weak spirit, just to stop you from glorifying God. The devil can use anybody to derail you, your husband, your wife, your relatives, your friends. Christians, beware. Be prayerful. We are within enemies. I come not to scatter the lost sheep, but to seek for them, as the Lord commanded Peter, feed my sheep. The psalmist sees the inconsistency of our human minds, where through the inspiration of God, he wrote this prayer in Psalm 119. Let thy hand help me, for I have chosen thy precepts. I have longed for thy salvation, O Lord, and thy law is my delight. Let my soul live, and it shall praise thee. And let thy judgment help me. I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek thy servant, for I do not forget thy commandments. Tonight, it's not for lengthy sermon, but to bring our minds back to all the events we have gone through, the good news we have heard, as well as the bad ones which through grief had made us to fear God. One, we thank God that when we started in January 2012, we were not able to fill all the chairs in the church. But now we have grown in number that we realize we have to start looking for a bigger church or build our own. And likewise, our children are greatly increasing in number, that their chapel is now getting too small for them. We praise God for that. Amen. And two, God has greatly blessed us in this church, that during the year 2012, we have had consummation of marriages, and our young mothers have successfully delivered babies without any complication. We give glory to God. Third, we thank God that during the year, we have not lost the life of any member through motor accidents, sickness, armed robbery, or bullets of assassins. Rather, God has been with us and brought us through all the dangers of the 2012. Yeah. For we thank God that despite all the crises and Satan's effort to destabilize us by throwing the seeds of rebellion and confusion into our midst, which could have disbanded other churches, God had hearkened to our ceaseless prayers and put Satan to shame. Amen. With our Lord, amen. With our Lord stepping in to sift the shaft and remove all the seeds of rebellion from our midst, while his anointed ones, whom Satan wanted to derail, are now glorifying God as chosen vessels in the church.
Amen.
Five, while we extend our condolences to those of our members who have suffered loss of father, mother, daughter, or relatives outside the church, we pray the Almighty God to bless and provide for the offspring that they left behind.
Amen.
We thank God for always providing solutions to our different human problems: loss of employment, loss of accommodation, marital crisis, and crisis within our job, which could have led to termination of our employment, but which God saved the situation, and litigations of any kind from which the Lord had protected us. We give glory to God.
Amen.
We are also thanking God today, especially the men ministry, for waking up, and the Lord Jesus making it possible for men to celebrate Father's Day.
Amen.
We have woken from our slumber.
Amen.
And with God on our side, we shall move God's people church to the next level.
Amen.
We thank God for the lives of our mothers in the church, as well as women ministry, for inspiring and motivating the men ministry to key themselves into the role Christ had ordained them to play in the life of the church. We compliment your efforts. While we pray for your more accomplishment in the new year. We thank God for our choir, especially the children ministry. While we are admonishing our church choir, as well as our youth ministry, to reorganize their houses and come up with better performances in the year 2013. We give glory to God for all the emerging talents with which God has blessed us in the church. We do encourage you to keep up the zeal and do not backslide, especially the praise and worship teams, as your ministry is one of Satan's targets. Because when you are praising and worshiping God, you are frustrating Satan's evil plan. Amen. So be on guard, especially you leaders, so that you may not fall. Hallelujah. Amen. We thank God. Amen. For seeing us through the year in our church activities, the Bible study and the prayer service have been very successful. While God has provided us with resources to still keep running the free food distribution program in compliance with our Lord's commands for the church to feed my sheep. We thank God for the lives of the dedicated people who God has used to sustain this program, regardless of weather, throughout the year. May God bless you all. We thank God for making it possible for us to host a successful annual clinic and our annual concert. We hope we shall learn from our unpatriotic actions and endeavor to make 2013 annual concert more successful and beneficial to the church. Individually. Amen. Individually. For those who put their trust in the Lord, they have experienced the grace of God in their life. I have, because I am better than what I was in January. Yes. And I'm sure many of us here tonight are thanking God for bringing them thus far. Yes. Lastly, I used to say that when you seek wisdom and you treasure it like diamond and write it on the tablet of your heart, it will save you from getting into trouble, as it will take miracle to get you out of trouble. Despite this warning, some of us still ignorantly ignore this warning and went ahead to exercise their rights of free choice. For those who have been saved by miracles, we are appealing to you tonight not to rush in. We are angels fear to tread.
Hallelujah.
And for those that are still in the cobweb of their wrong choices or actions, we pray to God to find solutions to your problems, because you have been warned. We are about entering into the new year. What are your resolutions for the church? Your family. When I say family, your spouse, your children, your siblings, your mother, your father, and relatives, and yourself and the society in which you are living. To enter the new year without any plan is like stepping behind a car with no steering wheel.
Amen.
And start driving, which scientists call stellar motion.
Yes.
And you then leave God to determine your destination.
Yes.
And I'm afraid God will not impose his will on your destiny, as he has given you your free will to exercise and expecting you to seek his spiritual guidance.
Yeah.
If you have no plan for the new year, you are just existing on scalar motion and not living, and you are wasting away your short life on this mother earth. We learn this wisdom from the book of Ecclesiastes 8, 10 to 12. Whatever your hands find to do, do it with all your might. For there is no activity of planning or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol, that is in the grave, where you are going. I again saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, and the battle to the warriors, or neither is bread to the wise, nor wealth to the discerning, nor favor to men of ability, for time and chance overtake them all. Moreover, man does not know his time. Like fish caught in a treacherous net, and birds trapped in a snare at an evil time when it suddenly falls on them. While you still have the opportunity to make the best of your life, do not waste it in idleness or unworthy career or venture that will not guarantee square meals on the table for your family. But to learn from the ants and save against a raining day. Make 2013 a year of accomplishments and commitments to God, your Creator, and it shall be well with you.
Amen.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life.
Amen.
And before the Lord departed to heaven, he left us a commandment, as we read in John 15:12-16. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if you do whatever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not servants, because servant doeth not what his master doeth, but I call you my friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you, that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you.
Amen.
I wish you all happy and prosperous New Year.
Hallelujah.
May God Almighty open the door of prosperity, grace, and mercy to each of us in the New Year, and protection to wade through and survive the tides of the New Year.
Amen.
Thank you, and God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Let us give the Reverend a big hand clap. Hallelujah. We thank you, Reverend, for always your teaching. We thank you always for your teaching. It is never sufficient. As the Reverend has said, we pray that we will keep this in our mind and it will not fall on stormy grounds. There is a new every morning, and as we are approaching the morning today, it's 11:16 right now, we will proceed with the program. Amen?
Amen.
Before our tithes and offering, I will call on the choir as one of our leaders will give us a couple of songs. Amen?
Amen.
God's people choir, you are welcome.